Oh, look at this beauty. Look at this beauty. So, today we're gonna add kind of this presentation support that everything is nice and presented nicely. So instead of zooming it in, we can fill the browser window automatically. And here's our Goombas and Koopas coming.
And as you can see, it should be sharp and nice on screen too.
We're also gonna try to solve the bug where you can jump on Goomba and multi-bounce, because we don't want multi-bounce. Oops. Blah. Nice.
First of all, we have a little nasty bug here, and it is that if we jump on the Goomba, oops, I'm gonna try to do that without dying. Here we go, we can continue bouncing on Goomba until he disappears from the level. We're not supposed to be able to do that, so our first goal is to fix that bug. So I have a pretty good idea of what we can do, so I'm gonna go into the code. We go into the stomper trait here, and so the stomper trait decides if we're gonna bounce or not. And what we could do here is just check if the subject or them, the one we hit, is already dead, then we shouldn't bounce. So let's refactor this method a little bit to take that into consideration. First of all, I want to split up this if statements a little bit. So I'm gonna put this on its own line. And this one is gonna be negative. And we're gonna return early if the killable trait is not on the entity we collide with. Then finally, we want to also return if they are not dead. So actually, we can do that in the same if statement here. So if they are not killable, or they are killable and they're dead, then we return. Otherwise, we're gonna bounce. In order to see if this is working correctly, we're gonna console.log. console.log out dem.killable to see what we get. So we go in here, open our little dashboard, our debugger tool, and let's see if we can get some data here from Goomba. Oops. Okay, boink, there we did. So now we didn't bounce at all. Let's see if we can find out why. So go in here, and I can see that we were already dead from the start. So the first time we hit Goomba, he was already dead. And this happens because the order of how we check objects is important. Let's debug this and see what's going on. Gonna open the entity collider. There we go. And I'm gonna set a little breakpoint debugger here. I'm also gonna disable the Koopa, so we only have a Goomba to worry about. So level.json. No, 1.1.json, I think. Is the Goombas down here or something? Here they are. Let's just remove the Koopa and reload. Okay, so we only have a Goomba now, and there can only be a collision between Mario and Goomba. So let's dash jump, boom, there we go. So this method here has detected that these two objects overlap. And now it's gonna send a signal to the subject and the candidate with the opposite, with the collider. So in this case, I think this is the Goomba. Yeah, we can see that the draw function is draw Goomba and the candidate is Mario. So now when we enter the Goomba collide method, we go like in here, then we go into the trait, and then we find the trait that is behavior. So this is the behavior trait, and we step into this, and you can see that we are not dead, so we continue down here. We are colliding with a stomper, and the stomper is coming from above. That means that we get killed, and in the kill method we set this.dead to true. So now I'm gonna step out of this. I'm gonna go back here. And now the opposite call is made. So this is gonna run collides on Mario. You can see we have draw Mario here. So let's step into this. We go into the trait here. And we want to find the stomper trait. So is this it? No. Let's continue to the next one. jump, killable, stomper. Go into stomper, and here we can see dem.killable exists, but they're already dead. So here we have a race condition that we can't control. Or I'm not sure this is actually a race condition, but basically it's undeterministic how things are happening depending on the order of objects. And we really want to avoid this, because now it's important what order we check the objects in, which is really hard to control. And we definitely don't want games that are dependent on small, minuscule, what do you call this? Like order of the things, unless you do something in a sequence. Because this will not be controllable at all, and will be super hard to enforce. So what I suggest doing here is that we go into the trait. Let's open this now, the killable trait. So this kill method, what it should do is not set the dead flag to true immediately, but instead it should queue the setting of the dead flag. Let me write how I want this to work, and then we implement the details. So, when this kill method is run, we queue up a task to run when we know it's safe. So in here, I want to say this.queue, and I want to send in a callback, and the callback is gonna say it's gonna set dead flag to true. So now let's see how we can implement this. This killable class extends the dead, extends the trait class. So let's open up the trait class, which exists in entity. We go to entity here, and let's start writing a little queuing task here. So queue is a method that takes a task that will be a function. It's kind of a callback. And it just pushes that into a stack. So this.tasks.push, push, and we push in the task here. And this tasks stack we should define in the constructor, and it's just going to be a normal array. And lastly, I want a method to process all the tasks. And that method is going to get the name finalize. So finalize. It is going to say this.tasks.forEach, and we get all the tasks out here. And on each task, we're gonna run the task. So quite simple. And after we run the tasks, we are going to set the task.length to 0. So that's kind of the equivalent of deleting all the tasks. Then we want the entity to have awareness of the tasks. So we're going to have a little finalize function or method here too. So we run finalize here. What do we bring in? We bring in nothing for now. But we do this.traits.forEach. And we get the trait out, of course. And then we run trait.finalize. Now the last thing we need to do is go into the level and run the finalize method. And as you see here, I'm going to run this after we do the collision. So the kind of the structure here is we update, then we test collision, and then we finalize. And finalize in our game engine means that we wrap up everything that happened in this loop iteration. So we don't need that. We don't need that. We're simply going to say entity.finalize. So we have three things. We have the outer part, which loops over the entities, last in the update loop, and runs finalize on them all. Then the finalize method runs the finalize method on all the traits. And when you run finalize method on a trait, if we go into the trait up here, we are going to loop over all the tasks that were queued during this loop time. And in the killable, we are utilizing this by saying this.queue, and we queue a function that sets the dead flag to true. Hopefully, this made it work. And bounce, and let's see that again. Wasn't clear enough. There we go, we can stomp on the Goomba without a problem. Let's have one more try from that. We can remove the Koopa, by the way. Don't get it in the way. There we go. Works flawless. What we also should do is to utilize this queue thing in the part which removes the entity. So if we're dead and we're supposed to be removing them, we should put that in a queue. And that can be simply done like that. We didn't really have a bug with this before, but I think this is the right way to queue a task that should happen after the update stage. Let's make sure that this works. I jump on Koopa, now Troopa Goomba. And that worked well too. Now I'm just gonna remove the console.log that we put there somewhere in the stomper, I think. There we go. Remove that, and we can move on to the next stage. Bum ba dum ba dum. Okay, in the last episode, we solved this Koopa problem here where the shell goes out of the level like that. And we solved that in a way that I think a little bit dirty. Let's have a look. I'm gonna close these files. And let's reopen entity. So we introduce this canCollide flag here that we in turn look at in the level thingamajig. And I don't like this way of doing things because it kind of, it's really hard to compose it and pick and choose what should use what. What you usually end up doing is just lose your hierarchical representation of what you're trying to do. So you end up having like a can collide with X, and then you might have false here, and then you have other things like draw it slowly. I don't know, but it's very common to see objects that has so many properties and sharing a lot of namespace, and I think that that's generally a very bad code smell. So we're gonna try to remove the canCollide property here and replace it with something more tasteful. The way I thought about doing this is to create a new trait that tells us that the object is solid and can collide with things. I'm gonna open the jump trait. I'm gonna save a copy of this. I'm gonna call this solid.js. And in here, I'm gonna do a little bit of cleanup first. We're gonna rename the class to solid. And the name of the class here, when it is applied as a trait, is going to be solid too. For now, we can remove all properties. And let's remove all methods too, except obstruct. The obstruct method is run by the tile collider. So when it finds that it is intersecting with a tile that is fixed, for example ground here, it's gonna say that, hey, I was obstructed by you. So we can utilize this by moving this part of the code into the obstruct call in the solid trait. Let's try that for the bottom first. Where do we have the bottom? Is it down here? And here we have bottom. So I'm gonna remove this from here, and then I'm gonna send in not only the side but also the match that we detected. So let's save this, and then we go back into solid here, and we actually already have this if statement that we need. So we're just gonna delete this part, and we can paste in the entity.bounce.bottom. Oh, sorry, paste in the part from the tile collider that resets the spot. And it looks like we have everything in order here. We just need to ask for the match argument here too. Finally, we can go into Mario and apply the solid trait to Mario. So I'm gonna import it up here. Import solid from .traits solid.js and apply it here. Where should we go with it? Let's have it first. Let's see how this behaves now. It broke. Nice. Let's see if we forgot something. Where did we break? We broke here because match doesn't seem to be the right thing or the expected thing. It's undefined. So let's go back into here. We have the obstruct. Oh, here we're actually losing the trait. We need to feed it through in this obstruct function too in the entity. So we open entity, and we make sure that the obstruct call is propagating the match. What we actually could do here is rewrite this to this. But I kind of like to be explicit with this, unless it's absolutely needed, for example, if you have dynamic arguments. So let's see here. We are breaking here, that should be fine. And match is now the tile, and everything looks kind of good there. So let's run this. That's pretty cool. So what is happening now is that only Mario is colliding with the ground, because he is the only entity where the solid trait is what is it called? Who has the solid trait applied to it. So we can just apply the solid trait to Goomba and the Koopa too. So let's go and do that. We go into Mario here. We copy the solid trait import. We open Koopa here. Import that. And we go down here and apply it. So Koopa.addTrait new solid. And let's do the same for Goomba. Goomba.addTrait new solid. So now we only have the bottom trait moved. So let's move the other parts too. I'm gonna go into the tile collider. And first gonna make sure that we always send back the match here. So let's copy this around. We need it here. We need it there. And then I'm just gonna move out this correction code from the tile collider and put that in the solid trait. So this was sides.write. That means in the solid trait, we're gonna set this else if side equals sides.write. Then we run this code. Dum, 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 dum. And back to the tile collider here. We're gonna do this for left too. So I'm cutting this out. And I'm pasting it in here on top of right, else if side equals sides.write, no, left of course. Then we run this code. And it looks like we only have one more. So tile collider, we have sides.top. There we go. Into solid you go. Else if side equals sides.top. There we go. So now we're gonna load up the game and make sure we didn't break it. So this seems to work now, but so far we haven't really reaped a benefit from it because we still have the canCollide flag. Because we still have the canCollide flag. But let's fix this. First of all, in the level loop, we can now simply remove the canCollide check. And we can do that here also in here, yes. I don't want to... We might break it a little bit now in case we don't do the correct check on collide. But that will be easily fixable in a trait later. So let's remove that from here too. And then we're going to add an enabled flag here to the solid. So this dot... Maybe we should call this obstructs. So I just call it obstructs equals true. And in the top of the obstruct method, we check the obstructs flag. So if not this.obstructs, then we return early. So now I think the game is broken again. I mean that Koopa will not, he will stay on ground when I jump here again. And that is true. However, we can now easily change that by setting a property on the solid trait. We go to Koopa. And where do we have this? And instead of setting canCollide, we set us.solid.obstructs to false. Let's try this out now with our new featured way. Kaplam, kaplam. And it worked as expected, and I think this is a much, much nicer way to handle this problem. While we're on the topic of adding traits and relieving this update method here, I want to do one more thing that I think this project has been begging for a while. And it is to decouple this logic here into something else. Whoops. So, because we're now sending in the level itself here into the update method, we can actually create a physics trait that take care of these things. So let's start with the simple solid trait we just added. And I'm gonna save this as physics.js. Let's rename this here, physics. And this name is also gonna be renamed to physics. There we go. And we're not gonna do anything else in the constructor right now. And we're not gonna have an abstract method either. But we are gonna have an update method. And this, of course, takes the entity that it is applied to. We get a delta time. And we get the level. This means we can now go in here into our, where was it, in the level. And we can pretty much just take this and move that into the physics trait. So physics, paste this in. And we just need to update a few references. We need to update this.tileCollider to look at the level, boink. And this.gravity needs to look at level.gravity. But I think that is it. Now, of course, no entity has this trait applied. So let's see what happens. Alright, so everything is just flying around in the sky because they have nothing is pulling them down and they're not interacting with anything either. But this is, of course, easy. So let's go to Mario, for example. And then we import the physics trait here. We get physics like that. And we apply it. Add trait new physics. Hoopla. Here we go. So now we can see that Mario is the only actor that has the trait. And let's see, but we should still be able to interact if I could just reach Koopa after. No, I can't. But let's apply the physics trait to Goomba and to Koopa and Goomba also. So I'm gonna take this, copy that, put it here into the Goomba. There we go. We add it, Goomba.add trait, new physics. And we do the same maneuver to Koopa. Where is Koopa? I guess it's not open. Here we go. Copy this, put it there, kind of there, and keyboards are tricky, aren't they? Okay, let's see. Physics. There we go. And now we can apply it. Koopa.add trait new physics. Let's make it rain. Kablam. So obviously this is magnitudes better in here than what we had. It also means that if we need to turn off physics for any reason, we can just add a little enable flag here. But let's keep it like this until we need it. Alrighty, I think that was a well-needed cleanup. I think, and I hope you agree. There's one more thing I want to do now, and I just decided that I'm not gonna do the scoring dashboard in this episode, because it's just gonna be too long to squeeze that in. Instead, we're gonna focus on making this the presentation of the game in the browser a little bit better. So let's reach for our CSS toolkit here. I'm gonna close down these files, that one too, and we're gonna open up the index.html. It should be, I have no clue, here probably. What? Here probably. There it is. Okay. First of all, I want to crop out this rubbish that we draw outside the canvas. So the reason I kept this in is because when you debug, you don't need it to be that clean. And because there is a risk that you obscure problems that you otherwise can see. But I think that our graphics drawing and background drawing and how everything behaves is quite stable. So I feel comfortable just cropping this out now. And it's very simple. We have set the canvas width and height here to what we draw on. So 256 for the width. And we're gonna do 224 for the height, I think. Let's see how this looks. Okay, let's add one more for the ground. So let's bring this up to 240 instead. But there we go. So now you see that we crop out the artifacts that for drawing. We don't need that, so it's a little bit cleaner now. And now I want to do something with the position here. And so let's start a style tag up here. Very simply, we just write style. And the first thing I'm gonna do is make the background of the body black. To say background to 000 in hex here. And let's see if that happened. Nicely nice. Now I want to get rid of the margin, and this is that margin I'm talking about here. So that can also be done on the body tag here. So I say margin 0. So let's see how that looks. That looks fine. And now I want the canvas window to always expand to the full window. So first of all, I'm actually going to zoom out here to 100%. Then I'm going to find the canvas by matching with the ID screen here. And to do that in CSS, you start with the hash and you write screen. And the screen's height, I'm going to set to 100% of the viewport height. So that's how you do that. And now the image is big and nice, but I want to center it. That can also be done very simply by just setting the margin out to on the screen. We forgot to do one thing. If margin is out to, we need to make this a block element. So display block. If you don't set this to display block, it will say that a canvas will by default be an inline element, so it will be treated kind of like something that can be squeezed in between two text elements. And those elements behave a little bit differently, so that's why we need to set the display type to block here. So now it's centered. Let's remove this. But we can see that it's a little bit blurry. Let's see how we can fix that. There is a special tag here in CSS that is called image rendering, and we've set that to pixelated. The blurriness should disappear. And it did. I think we have seen that we kind of draw on in between pixels. But to be honest, I haven't seen the artifacts of that right now. So I'm not gonna try to fix that until that is a problem again. I think right now I'm super happy with how this looks. It looks clear and sharp, and there don't seem to be any horrific artifacts as of now. But if you do find them, please let me know and we will see if we can do something with the camera drawing. And this was actually everything I wanted to do in this episode. So we have polished away some bad behaviors, and we have fixed the presentation of the game so that it looks much more inviting to start playing it. And we have also, that was actually only the two things we did. But that's fine. So, shorter episode today with cleanups. That means that we can create the next episode where we do dashboard and scorings faster. Thanks again for watching.